Praise the Lord, everybody. It is good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. We thank God for another opportunity to come into his house and break the bread of life with you tonight here at New Vision for Christ Ministries Bible Study. And as we say all the time, that this is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. Turn with us as we go into the Word of God tonight to the book of St. Matthew, the 18th chapter. And we're going to begin reading at the 15th and read through the 17th verses tonight. The book of St. Matthew, the 18th chapter, beginning reading at the 15th and reading through the 17th verses. And the scripture reads, "Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. And if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it to the church, but if he neglect to hear the church, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a publican." The word of God is always a blessing to those who hear it, understand it, and are obedient unto it. If I would have a title for the teaching tonight, it is, "Don't expect your love and forgiveness to change everyone." Don't expect your act of love and forgiveness to change everyone. You know, I think for me as a Christian, one of the most difficult things for me to adjust to once I got saved is, you know, the philosophy and doctrine of Jesus to show love and forgiveness. Because, you know, a lot of times, before we got saved, when people had done things to us or said things to us that offended us, a lot of times we would hold on to that, and it caused so many negative attitudes and negative behaviors when you refuse to forgive and you don't have the proper level of love that you should have. But once we become Christians, we find out that God has mandated us to learn how to show love and learn how to truly forgive. I want us to turn to another set of scriptures, because I want you to see where these scriptures are, where Jesus begins to command us, amen, to begin to practice Christian character. In St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, and the 43rd through the 48th verses. St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, beginning reading at the 43rd and reading through the 48th verses. And this one is dealing with loving your enemies. Jesus says, "You have heard that it has been said that thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto thee that you should love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth rain on the just as well as the unjust. For if we will love them which love you, what reward have ye? Do not even the publicans do the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do ye more than others? Do not even the publicans do so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." Now here Jesus gives us the command that we should love our enemies and bless them that curse you, and be good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use and persecute you. This is the banner that we should be waving at Christians. that even our enemies should know that we have the power to love them in spite of. Amen. Now, let me tell you something. See, I know this is a challenge for a lot of people, but it is the doctrine of Jesus Christ. You know, many times when we talk about the doctrine of Jesus Christ, it is very difficult sometimes because of the way we are and the way we've been taught to incorporate these principles, these doctrinal principles, into our life. We're going to go ahead and read the next set of scriptures dealing with forgiving people. It's in Matthew, the 6th chapter. It's right next door. Matthew, the 6th chapter, beginning with the 14th and reading through the 15th verses. The book of St. Matthew, the 6th chapter, beginning with the 14th and reading through the 15th verses. And the scripture reads, and this is Jesus talking also, "For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Now, hey, pay attention. This is Jesus talking. Jesus says, if you don't have the ability to truly and completely forgive people, then your Father in heaven, amen, will not forgive you. One thing we should learn about forgiveness is that, you know, when you don't forgive people, and I wanna say this right here, when you don't forgive people, it can bring so many negative attitudes into your mind and into your spirit. You know, when you don't forgive people, you know, you become hateful sometimes. When you don't forgive people, you become bitter. When you don't forgive people, you become revengeful sometimes. When you don't forgive people, you walk in anger. When you don't forgive people, you become discouraged. So we must really police ourselves when it comes to understanding the power of forgiveness. You know, a lot of times it's hard for us to show these characteristics because we don't completely understand them. So I want to talk about and expound on this thing of completely forgiving someone. You know, the meaning of forgiveness is to pardon. To pardon means the action of being forgiven for an offense. And if we were to have a parable or a saying, amen, that symbolizes what does it mean to pardon somebody, it is likened unto a debt that was owed, and then you were released of it. Look at what the word pardon means. It is likened unto a debt that was owed, and then you were forgiven and released of it. Now, look, so this is why it's important for us to learn how to forgive, because forgiveness is, for the most part, it's for the forgiver. Amen? And I think when we learn the power of forgiveness in this respect, it'll be easier for us to forgive people, because when you truly forgive people, according to how the Bible says that we forgive people, we will take into account that, look, someone has done something to me, someone has offended me, someone has hurt me, but I must forgive them because I don't want what they have done to me or what they have said to me or how they have offended me for me to have a negative attitude and a negative behavior, and I corrupt and poison my spirit and my mind with all of these negative things that it is causing within me. We've got to get to the place where we know that the power of forgiveness is for the person who is forgiving, because we don't have the power nor the authority to make people change. And even when we do our best to show people love and we do our best to forgive people and try to convey this unto people, it does not cause people to change. So what you should do with forgiveness is you should say, look, Lord, I need you to help me get past the hurt and get past the pain that this person or these persons have caused in my life. The best thing you can learn how to do is turn it over to God and let God start the healing process within you. But God cannot start the healing process until you truly forgive the person. Somebody said, well, Pastor Green, how do I know when I truly forgive someone? When you can get past the pain and you can get on with your life. Because if you hold on to this type of pain, it can have an effect on your life. Well, it will affect everything in your life. And then you're giving people power over you and the way you live and the way you act and the way you perform. And it can hinder your progress to the point where you can have goals and dreams in life, but you get stuck there. You get stuck there wherein it will cause you not to be able to be the best person you could be. You know, it's kind of like dumping, taking baggage off of a train or a plane. You know, this kind of baggage, it will wear you out and wear you down if you're not careful. So what you got to learn how to do is say, Lord, you know what? I'm depending on you, God, to heal whichever way this thing has damaged me mentally or spiritually or emotionally or sometimes physically. We are damaged by what people say. We are damaged by what people do, or either we are broken by what people say and we are broken by what people do. But we must get to the place where we can say, I truly forgive a person. Now, let's talk about this also. When you truly forgive someone, it doesn't mean that you completely trust them, because you forgiving them does not bring deliverance from them, for them. You forgiving them, amen, as a matter of fact, it might cause them to be more angry with you when you forgive people. And when you say, you know, I truly love you in spite of how you've treated me and what you've done to me. Because the Bible says, you know, when you show people love like your enemies, it heaps coals of fire on your head. Then you begin to understand why Jesus has told us, amen, in the scriptures we read earlier, that when you have an enemy, that you should love them, and then when people are trying to curse you, you should bless them, and then you should pray for your enemies, and you should love your enemies, because what it does, it keeps them from having power and authority in your life. When you learn that this is the way forgiveness helps you to overcome the hurts and the pains that people have caused in your life. You wouldn't believe, as a pastor, how many people I've talked to during the course of the years and how long that they have carried certain pains and certain hurt in their life. And some of them are in their 40s and 50s and 60s, and they're still talking about things that have hurt them and wounded them from their childhood. And it's a shame for people with so much potential, amen, not to reach their potential because someone else has done something to them and caused them to be stagnated in reference to the progress of their life and the potential that they have in their life. Do not shortchange yourself and do not give people that kind of power where they can limit what you do in life. Too many times when you don't forgive people, it stays in the forefront of your mind. When you have things in the forefront of your mind, it's in the way of other productive thoughts, amen, having the process, the proper process to evolve inside of your mind. This is why when you forgive people, you turn it over to God and you say, God, I place them in your hands. Even if they don't change, God, it's not my responsibility to change them. It is my responsibility, like Jesus have told us, to do two things. Amen. To love them and then forgive them. I want to read another scripture, and we're not going to be up here long tonight, but what I want people to realize is that when you practice these doctrines that Jesus have said about love and forgiveness, it will help clear your spirit and clear your mind, amen, that you can operate as a vessel and not be held back and not be held down by something you can be delivered from just by understanding the word of God and just being empowered by the truth that the Bible speaks in a lot of cases in reference to how people treat us and what people have done to us. Many times people will use this as an excuse and say, you know, if it wasn't for this person, or if it wasn't for that person, or if it wasn't for this thing that happened to me, or that thing that happened to me, you know, I could have been this, I could have been that. Let me tell you something. Don't live in a life of shoulda, coulda, woulda, if I had them. Because one thing about time, once you waste time, amen, you're wasting opportunities. Once you waste opportunities, there is no way that you can be the best that you can be. Too many times, as Christians, we don't forgive people and we don't love who we love. Now, notice Jesus says, look, if we love like the world loves, then There is no virtue in us loving like the world loves. Our love must go beyond how the world loves each other. Amen. I hope I can get a loud amen tonight. That, you know, we being Christians, our love is supposed to be different. Amen. Our love is supposed to have the ability to love the unlovable. Amen. And I hope you understand this tonight. You know, your love, if it's not able to love the unlovable, then you don't have the love of God. You cannot convey the love of God. You can't show the love of God until you can love the unlovable. I'm quite sure that there's a lot of people that have had people in their life that are unlovable, and they have done things to you, and it is hard for you to convey the love. And you say, well, Pastor Green, what does this love represent? I tell you what the love represents. Amen. You don't love what they're doing. You don't love how they're being used and how they're walking in evil and how they're doing things to purposely help hurt people. You're not loving them because of that. You know what you do? You love them. Listen to this very closely. You love them because they are human beings. You love them because they are God's creation. You do not love their sin. You do not love the evil acts that they commit. But because they are a human being, amen, you are willing to assist them if they would accept help from you. But you still have to extend love. You say, well, Pastor Green, there are terrible people out there, and people can do some wicked and evil things. I know. I know that there are people out there, and they can do some wicked and evil things. But your responsibility as a Christian is to love them. When you are able to love the unlovable, then you walk in a realm where you can always secure peace and joy. Amen. That, you know, sometimes we're looking for peace and we're looking for joy. And, you know, we're always talking about joy unspeakable and full of glory and the peace which passes all understanding. Well, we got to get to the place where we know how to get that peace and get that joy. The way you do it is you love properly and spiritually, and you forgive like you're supposed to forgive. When you can operate, amen, in this level upon this premise that Jesus has spoken unto us, then you can establish peace and joy within yourself, and there's nothing like it. Amen. There is nothing like it when you can live on this level as a Christian. Go with me as we read some more scripture in the Bible to the book of St. Matthew, and we're going back to the book of St. Matthew and the 18th chapter, because many of us are like this. The book of St. Matthew, the 18th chapter, and we're going to read the 21st and 22nd verses. Now, we find out when we get to St. Matthew 18, we find out that the lead scripture we read, Jesus was talking about when you're dealing with someone and you're trying to make peace with them, and because the Bible said, you know, if your brother have aught against you, you go to them. And let me tell you something. A lot of us, we've got that. This is the first step right here. That it didn't say, you know, if the people have aught against you, you wait for them to come to you. The Bible says when you find that your brother, and this is Jesus talking, that if you find out that your brother have aught against you, then you go to them. You say, well, Pastor Green, they're wrong. Why should I go to them? Because you are the Christian. Hello. You are the one that's supposed to have this love, and you are the one that's supposed to be operating on this highest spiritual level. You're the one that's supposed to be walking in forgiveness. If you're walking in this level, then you won't have a problem, even if the people are wrong, going to them and says, hey, can we have peace between one another? Oh, we're going to have to change the way we think. If you change the way you think, you'll change the way you act. When you change the way you act, you'll have different results, people. Come on. So the Bible says, if someone has an ought against you, you go to them. And then it tells them, you know, you go to them, and if they don't receive it, then you take some witnesses with you. Take a couple of witnesses with you and go back to them with their wrong self. Go back to them and say, look, can we straighten out this matter? I really don't want to be at odds with you. I don't like to have dissension and division and strife with people. Can we please talk it out? Can there be some reconciliation? I do forgive you, and I do love you, and I do want to work with you. I don't think you're a bad person. Boy, some of you all are saying right now, Pastor Green, I've got a lot of maturing and growing to do. Well, you better start tonight then. Hallelujah, you better start tonight. Because then Jesus turns around and says, look, if they don't want to hear you with the two witnesses, he said, bring them before the church. Bring them before the church and see if you can straighten it out with the presbytery of the church. And when the presbytery of the church, when they discuss it, see if you can work it out then. Now, the scriptures in St. Matthew, the 18th chapter, the 21st and 22nd verse, this is how a lot of us are. Once Jesus says this parable, watch this now. Once Jesus says this parable, the Bible says, then came Peter unto him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? 22nd verse. Jesus said unto him, I say unto thee, until seven times, not unto thee seven times, but until 70 times seven. Now watch this. Listen to me very closely. Now look, Peter says, Lord, I'm going to be honest with you. Now look, it's a challenge for me to be forgiving these people. You know, I've gone to him three times, and you're telling me I have to keep going back to people when they have wronged me, and this is the power of walking in love and in forgiveness. Peter said, and we all know Peter was kind of impulsive. Peter was the type of person that, I mean, you know, he's the same guy that pulled out a sword when they came to get Jesus, and the Bible says he cut one of the soldiers' ear off, you know. Peter was the type of person where you find out he'll say things sometimes and he'd be out of line. And one time, amen, Jesus, when Jesus was talking about going to Calvary's cross, Peter said, "It shall not be so, I won't let him." And Jesus had to rebuke Peter. So Peter was a very outspoken person. He was a very aggressive person. Come on, somebody. So then Peter says, "Look, Lord, I want to really understand what you're talking about here, because, okay, I'm going to come up with a number." And you know what? This is where Peter made a mistake. Peter said, "What I want to do, Jesus, I want to come up with a number of how many times I have to forgive people, you know, with their bad self, with their wicked self, with their evil self, with their wrong self." Peter said, "How many times I have to forgive?" And you know what? It's one of the few times in the Bible where you see Jesus delve into sarcasm. Really? Jesus delved into sarcasm right here. And Jesus says, not seven times, but seven times 77. Now, Jesus says, "You got to keep on forgiving them, even if it's the same person." Now, a lot of us, oh, Jesus, help us today. Would you please help us today? Jesus said, if it's the same person and they're doing the same thing, amen, forgive them and just love them anyway, and that's the way you're going to stay free from them having power over you. Amen. Look at the principle Jesus was trying to teach you. Jesus says, look, don't worry about how many times they're doing the same thing. How many of us tonight, how many of us know people who we've been telling the same thing for years? Some of us, we got people. Most of us got people that we've been telling these people the same thing over and over, how to correct this in their life, how to correct that in their life. Let me tell you something. I'm a pastor, and I've told some of these members in my church the same thing over and over, and they want to come talk to me, and I usually, they have to fill out paperwork to come talk to me about circumstances and situations in their life. And when I find out that I've given them counsel in reference to this situation and they have not been obedient to the word that I have given them and the guidance that I've given them, amen, I do not waste my time with people, amen, who do not correct themselves. But I must still love them. Come on, somebody. I must still love them. I must still treat them the same. I must show them the love, amen, that they deserve as a human being, even when they are in error. Peter said, "I don't know if I could do this." And Jesus said, "You're going to be better off when you learn how to do this." When you learn how to do this. Now, I know what some of you are saying. You're saying, well, Pastor Green, looky here, you know, can you get us a scripture? Do you have a scripture that says, if I start to love on this level and if I start to behave myself on this level of forgiveness, you know, is there a scripture that you have for me tonight that I can truly follow this and I can study it for myself and I can absorb it into my spirit so that I can actively, because, you know, this is a problem that I'm quite sure that challenges people in reference to the subject that I'm talking about tonight. You know, a lot of times we say that we have forgiven a person of something. We will say it verbally, but inwardly, listen to me tonight, but inwardly, You know, we still have an issue with them. And we still have a problem with it. And when they come in our company and in our presence, you know, it turns our stomach and we start to become tense. Start to become tense with it. What I'm proposing tonight, I want you to learn how to completely love and completely forgive so that you can be set free. Pastor Screen, I'm not the one that's the perpetrator. I am the victor. Well, let me tell you something. As a Christian, if you are the victim, you got to be the bigger person. Amen. As a Christian and you're the victim, then you're commanded to still show love. And you're commanded by the Lord Jesus Christ, amen, to forgive people and truly forgive people. This means that if the people do change, that you're there for them and they feel like they can come to you, amen, and get some assistance and some help because they have realized your ability to love them when they were in their mess. Now, if we are to be witnesses for the Lord, it means that God has called us to be soul winners. Come on now. This is our ministry, to be soul winners, you know, to be witnesses and to go ye therefore in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, even to the uttermost parts of the earth, and preach the gospel and try to win people to Christ. Amen. This is our responsibility. This is our calling. This is what God has anointed us to do. No matter what your position is in the church, no matter what your title is, amen, you're a servant of God. You're supposed to get people saved, amen, by living before them and witnessing unto them how good Jesus Christ is, how powerful it is to be saved, the power of his love, the power of his counsel in your life. You're supposed to be that example. And if people cannot feel that and realize that, then you cannot win them over to the Lord. So we got to get some of these basic things right within us. And we got to stop telling people, I love you when you really don't love people, and telling people, I forgive you when you really don't forgive people. Come on, somebody. We as Christians, we got to get our character right. Hallelujah. So, and I know you said, well, Pastor King, what must I do to do this? Hey, first thing you need to do is, like, be honest with yourself. All the people that you haven't forgiven, go ahead and forgive them. You don't have to forgive them face to face. Amen. And you don't have to love them face to face. Amen. But when you come in contact with them, they cannot feel animosity from you. Amen. They cannot feel that you don't want to help them. And I know some of us are like Peter. How many times must this be? How many times, Lord, do I have to do this? Jesus was saying, it's not the amount of times you have to do it, it's that you have to show it every time because you're trying to win a soul. Can we get this right tonight, that you're trying to win a soul? St. Matthew, the 7th chapter. I want you to turn to these scriptures tonight because I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you with the love that you're supposed to show and the forgiveness that you're supposed to show. We got some husbands and some wives up in here tonight looking at this broadcast. You need to forgive your husband and you need to forgive your wife of some things. Amen. We have children that need to forgive their parents. We have families, amen, that we're connected with, that you got to learn how to forgive each other. And you got to learn how to truly love each other. It is the power of love. And this is why the Bible says that God is love. Amen. And then Jesus tells us when you practice these two things correctly, that you walk in the realm of perfection and you reflect your Father. Now watch this. St. Matthew, the 7th chapter, the 24th through the 27th verses. I want you to turn to it. St. Matthew, the 7th chapter, the 24th through the 27th verses. Because this is Jesus saying, if you follow these sayings, that it shall benefit you. All this, all the love and all the forgiveness that I've been preaching about, this will help you as a believer and as a person. So if you want to help yourself, you need to follow these principles. If you want to help yourself, people can preach it to you day and night. But until you want to take it into action in your life and you actually want to practice it, it will do you no good to read about it, preach about it, sing about it. Hallelujah. The scripture reads, therefore, whosoever shall hear these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken them unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Now, in St. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Jesus has all these doctrinal principles that he lays out. And so when he talks about love and when he talks about forgiveness, he says, look, if you really learn how to do this the way it should be done, as God has given you power to do, he says that it will be better for you. It will build, listen to what Jesus says, it will build a foundation in your life where there will be nothing in your life. And this is how he puts the parable. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Jesus says, when you follow principles like this, and you practice principles like this, everything that tries to come into your life to kill, steal, and destroy, it does not have the ability to tear your house down, to destroy you as a person, to get you off course, to make you think that you can't do this or can't do that. He says, when you walk in the fullness of love and in the fullness of forgiveness, it is a foundation that you can stand on regardless of what is going on in your life. It will ease the pains and the ills of being a victim. And I know some of you, you know, some of you, when you are victims of people perpetrating things against you, you become defensive. And see, this is the problem. You become defensive, but you defend yourself in the wrong way. Amen. Now, this is the defense you should use when you're a victim. When people say, well, you know, I hate you. Your response should be, you know, I love you. That's what your response should be. When people say, you know, I'll never forgive you of that. Well, you'll say, well, you know what? If I was in your place, I would forgive you. Yeah. Yeah, because that's what I walk in. I walk in love. And no matter how much you say you hate me, I will always love you. This is what he's trying to tell Peter. Amen. Never, never, never go hate for hate. Amen. Never, never go an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. Amen. Never do that, because they're drawing you over to the dark side. Yeah. Yeah, I know it sounds like, you know, something from the Star Wars movie, but yeah, we can't let people draw us to the dark side. You know, Jesus said men love darkness, amen, when their deeds are evil. We don't love darkness. Now, if you don't love darkness, stop allowing them to draw you to the dark side. Yeah, if you don't walk in the power of love like the Bible commands us, and you don't walk in the power to forgive like the Bible commands us, then they're winning. They're winning and you are losing. And you know what? You've got to stop talking about the people who have hurt you. Because You talking to other people about them means that you really haven't forgiven them. And you're still walking in the pain. You still have it. It hasn't gone anywhere. That's why the Bible says, and it says this twice in the Bible in the New Testament, that when you have order against, when people have order against you, that you go to them. And see, for Christians, this is what we should be doing. Listen to your word tonight. Amen. That we should be the ones going to them. We should be the peacemakers. This is why Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Amen. If you really want to be a peacemaker on the level that God commands us to be a peacemaker, then you got to walk in the fullness of love. You got to walk in the fullness of forgiveness. Learn how to do that. Now watch this. Jesus says, you have a great foundation when you walk in this. He turns around in the 26th verse and he says, and everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. If you cannot walk in the level of love and the level of forgiveness that God has called you to, then the enemy can come into your house and things can come into your house, and it has the ability to tear your life apart. This is why some of you, you have not been able to build in your life. You have not been able to make progress in your life. You've not been able to live out your potential because you keep holding on to the things that hold you back. You've got to let go of some of these things. When you let it go, amen, and this is what the Bible, you know, continues to tell us. You got to let go of hate, and you got to let go of being revengeful. You got to let go of strife. You got to let go of all these negative things in your life. Amen. You got to really learn how to lay aside every weight. You know, most people, when they read that scripture where it says lay aside every weight and the sin, everybody just want to talk about the sin, but people don't want to emphasize the weight. And there's too many Christians, you have gotten rid of the sin, but you're still carrying weight that you shouldn't be carrying. Amen? When you carry weight that you should not be carrying, it wears you out. Come on, somebody. And this is why the Bible says it. Lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets you. When you don't know how to love and you don't know how to forgive, then you carry around weight. And you're not going to be able to perform at your best. Let me tell you something. If I jump on your back and you have to carry me around, you'd be better off without me on your back, wouldn't you? You can go farther. You could do more without me on your back. Come on, somebody. That's what weight does. Weight interferes with your ability to evolve into what you should be in God. Jesus says, it's things like this that stops us from being as great as we should be in Him. It stops us from doing all the awesome things that He has called us to do. And there are a couple of examples I want to talk about before I close today with this teaching. When we go to the book of Acts, the 7th chapter and the 60th verse, the book of Acts, the 7th chapter and the 60th verse, we find the story of Stephen, and he's preaching the gospel, and they decide, because of his preaching of the gospel, because they had told them not to preach the gospel, they decide to take him out to the edge of the city and stone him to death. The Bible says he does not resist. He does not fight against them. They take him out to the edge of the city, and the Bible says they even gather the stones that he did not run away from his enemies. And the Bible says he waited for them to gather around him. He was not in chains, and he was not in shackles. And the Bible says they began to throw stones and began to break the bones of his body. And he did not move. But the Bible did say in Acts 7, chapter 60, verse, that Stephen kneeled down and cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, lay not this sin to their charge." That's love right there. Lord, I know that you're calling me home today. I know that I'm not going to go back home and see my friends and my family. I know this is the day that I die. But the last thing I want to do while I'm alive is I want you to forgive these people who are killing me. You know how powerful that is? Forgive these people, God, who are stoning me to death. Forgive these people who are shortening my lifespan. And let me tell you something. Stephen was one of the youngest preachers at that time. And he had that much wisdom to say, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to show the power of love and forgiveness while I'm dying. And it'll be the message I'll leave to those who shall kill me today. My last message to them is, I love you and I forgive you. Wow. How many of us can walk in that realm? Can walk in that level of love and level of forgiveness? The same thing that Jesus did in St. Luke, the 23rd chapter and the 34th verse. St. Luke, the 23rd chapter and the 34th verse, where it says, then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It's the same thing. Jesus is on the cross, and the Bible says he knows he's going to die that day. And so all of them who have said from the beginning, even before he's up on the cross, the ones who have decided that says, we've got to kill him, because if we don't kill him, the whole world has gone after him. And those soldiers who came to get him when he was in the garden and took him away, and those that led him unto Pilate, and those who said, give us Barabbas. Amen. Give us Barabbas. And when they brought Jesus, everybody said, crucify him. Crucify him. And everybody that abused him that day, everybody that plucked his beard out, and the people that put the stripes on his back, and everyone that mocked him as he marched to Golgotha's hill, everyone that says he saved others and he cannot even save himself, the man who stripped his clothes off, and the Bible said they were gambling for his clothes and his cloth that was on his body. And standing in the face of those who says, call yourself a king now, mocking him while he's on the cross, bleeding from head to toe with a crown of thorns on his head and blood dripping from his hands and his feet. And the soldier comes and sticks a sword in his side. And Jesus, knowing that all this is taking place and will take place, he says, Father, I only have one message with my dying breath. And it is, Lord, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When we can walk in this level of love, and this level of forgiveness, whatever will come into your house, whatever will try to destroy you, Jesus said, you'll have power over it when you can walk in this kind of love and this kind of forgiveness. I hope that the word of God have ministered unto you tonight. Don't expect your acts of love and forgiveness to change everybody. They probably will not change. But what you got to remember, the love and forgiveness you show them, it's for you first. And when you can walk in it, then that's what's important. And this is what Jesus was telling Peter. 77 times 7. The reason you love and the reason you forgive is for you. If it just so happens changes someone, so be it. But the main reason you love and forgive is to keep yourself free, that I can continue to use you for my glory, for my honor, and for my kingdom. All of you who have this weight tonight, I want you to lay it aside. And I want you to seriously get rid of the weight tonight. And I want you to pray about it. And I want you to pray earnestly about it. That, Lord, let me love like you love. Let me forgive like you forgive, God. Lord, let me be that servant, God. Let me be that Christian, God, that when people leave my presence, they'll feel like that they've come in contact with someone who knows God personally and is willing to love me in spite of my faults and in spite of the wickedness and in spite of the evil and in spite of the shortcomings I've had in my life, in spite of all the mistakes that I've made. Lord, I thank you that I know that there are some Christians that I could come back to. Even though I made the same mistakes, I can come back to them. And I know that if they believe that I'm serious in changing, they'll reach out to me and they'll love me in spite of myself. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. This is what the world is looking for. The Bible says the earth is moaning and groaning, awaiting for a manifestation of the sons of God. And you know what? People need to see God in our life, not just a God that blesses us with houses and land, silver and gold, wealth and fame and fortune and healing and deliverance and salvation, but they need to know that he's a God that has taught us how to love and how to forgive. Amen? Amen. I know there are some of you that have been watching the broadcast tonight that you're not saved and you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sins and in the power of his resurrection. The Bible says now is the acceptable time and the day is a day of salvation. The Lord is still saving. The Lord is still moving. And he's still loving the unlovable, and he's still forgiving the unforgivable. He's asking today, do you want to be saved? Do you want to know him in the pardon of your sins and in the power of his resurrection? He's available today. All you got to do is believe that he lived, that believe that they put him on a cross and believe that the blood that he shed on Calvary's cross was for the remission of your sins. And believe that he died on that cross and that they put him in a tomb and that on the third day he rose from the grave with all power in his hands. When he got up, we got up with him. Bible says if you profess that with your mouth and believe in your heart that the Father raised him from the dead, then you shall be saved. If this is your confession today, then you are saved and no one can take that from you. And in the name of Jesus, may the Holy Spirit begin to deal with you and minister unto you and to teach you all the principles that God has in his word to make you know him in a greater way, in Jesus' name. If you don't have a home church, we welcome you to come Join us here at New Vision for Christ Ministries when we open back up. We're not open at this time, but we're working diligently to open up real soon. Amen. But we're not open to the public at this time. But pray for us that we complete all of the necessary things that we have to do to make the church a safe environment for us to come back and worship and praise God. Also, I want to thank everyone who continues to sow into the kingdom of God through this ministry. It is by and with your support that you allow us to continue to go forward to do that which God has called, planned, purposed, and ordained for us to do. We thank you for using all of our social media platforms to sow your seeds and thank God for the faith you have. I know some of you attend other churches, but you see that we are doing a positive work for the Lord and you're still sowing seed into the ministries. We appreciate you. Also, those of you who continue to pay your tithe, amen, we thank you also. And may God bless you 100-fold for your obedience unto him. This Sunday once again is the first Sunday. And because it's the first Sunday, we're going to come together one more time and we're going to take communion. Make sure you have all your supplies, amen, together on Sunday. You have your wafer, your cracker, or your bread, and you have your drink. And we're going to come together and recognize the power of Jesus. And we're going to have communion with one another and have communion with the Lord. So prepare yourselves on Sunday. It is the first Sunday. This is also Breast Cancer Month. And those of you who visit our website, you see that it is shaded in pink because we want to bring awareness, amen, to all of those who are in the fight right now. Those of you who are battling cancer to whatever the degree, those of you who your lives have been affected by ones you love and ones you care about that are in the fight also. We're still interceding here at New Vision for Christ Ministries, not just for cancer, but for all sickness, diseases, and infirmities. We urge you to follow all the guidelines for early detection because the life you save pretty well might be your own. You pray for us, and we will continue to pray for you. Continue your intercessory prayer for those who are less fortunate than you are. Don't just pray for yourselves. Pray for the least, the lost, and the left out, and the downtrodden, because people need the power of God in their life. So continue your intercessory prayer. Join us once again this coming Sunday as the Word of God goes forth at 11 a.m. And we will be live streaming at that time. May the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to continue to shine upon you and give you peace is our prayer. We're not just a church. We are a movement. God bless you. Love you.